So good morning to one and all. This is Dr. Pranay Dutte, and today we are going to see the application of remote sensing for the tsunami. This is a part of your subject geoinformatics for geohazard, and the objective of this lecture is to know about what kind of technology we are using for the remote about tsunami. You all may be heard about here about what is the tsunami and or annually, but when it occur, it having a substantial or a very large scale destruction in an area of the coast. So the basic understanding about the tsunami is caused by the earthquake. Tsunami is caused by the earthquake. Why did the earthquake cause the tsunami? When there is a shallow focus earthquake. So when you have an earthquake, there is a different phenomena associated with earthquake. One is a focus, one is an epicenter. Okay, so focus and epicenter, two things are associated with the earthquake. Whatever the your earthquake you are observing on a earth surface, that is originated from the subsurface. So the subsurface motion or subsurface whatever the process has been take place, that is having some depth, means some processes has been taken place on the your 2 kilometer, 15 kilometer, 20 kilometer, 60 kilometer, 200 kilometer, 300 kilometer, 500 kilometer, something like that. So you have a different kind of depth, and so that's the points of origination of earthquake waves is known as a focus, whereas the point above the your surface is known as epicenter. So focus is maybe sometime a shallow, medium or deep. Shallow, intermediate and deep, three depths we are dividing with. So the shallow focus earthquake are the main threatening for the this tsunami. So by the shallow focus earthquake you have a large destruction. And what the large destruction? Large volume of oceanic crust is displaced from one place to the another place. A large volume of oceanic crust is displaced from one place to another place by the your earthquake. What is that earthquake? The shallow focus earthquake. The earthquake is a shallow focus earthquake. So that shallow focus earthquake is taking a displacement of a oceanic crust. The movement of the crust also displaces in a large volume of water. So obviously it's not like that they are the inhomogeneous or heterogeneous in nature. The water and the crust is act as together. So when the crust is get displaced, at the same time your water is also get displaced. So when tsunami is occurred, the one wave moves toward the shoreline, another travel into the opens. So when the tsunami is at shoreline, not a gigantic version of breaking wave, very rapidly rising tide rushing inland and sometime water retreat first. So this is a example of the some of the picture is showing the what the tsunami when it occurred to the shoreline. When it occurred to the shoreline, like just like you can see. So water is rotated in a circles. When it take to the shoreline, water is rotate in a circle. So what this affect and what this having a cost, because of this you have the height of this show waves has been very increased or very at a good height. It's having in a good height. So what is the period or what is the timing for this one? A series of wave may arrive every 10 to 60 minutes. So you have a open ocean. So wavelength is get increase, and toward the shoreline, it after every 10 to 60 minutes, it get a cycle of the waves. So tsunami when occur, shallow water waves, because of as they travel across the ocean and drag on the bottom up to 18,000 feet on the ocean surface, the wave is barely detectable 3 feet high. So when you have a tsunami, so that time you have the shallow water waves, that is shallow water waves, because they travel across the ocean and track the bottom up to 18,000 feet. On the ocean surface, the wave is barely detectable. So you may when you are on oceanic shoreline, you have a two different type of waves, or you also have the experiencing of wind waves and the tsunami waves. So what is the wind wave? Wind wave means when you have a wind wave plus your whatever the exact movement of the rotation and this one of the moon and the relationship between moon and earth, that time also you have some large waves. So in a wind wave, how you can differentiate between wind wave and this tsunami wave? The wind waves are generally a single wave, and the single wave which having a water mass. The velocity of this wave is depend upon the period of wave. Okay, so it's up to a 17 meter per hour for 5 second wave, up to the 70 meter per hour for 20 second wave. So this is a wind waves, whereas tsunami, huge mass of water with tremendous movement. So the tsunami is talk about the tsunami, that if any person is having a so much anger, we say that is the tsunami is there, he is so much of angry and all. So tsunami is a foremost and the very tremendous movement of water has been occurred in a tsunami. So velocity of these waves increase in a velocity with the increase in depth. So that it get directly proportional to the depth. So when you have a velocity, it's when the depth of this one is a higher one, your velocity is also get higher. So velocity of the tsunami is particularly depend upon the depth. So it get a momentum, a proper momentum, and the depth to get all this momentum. So velocities in open ocean is more than you can see the average depth of the ocean, Pacific Ocean, is 18,000 feet. If you get go and convert this in a meter and then kilometer, you can find something like 12 and something kilometer. So you have a large depth, or the very high depth of the Pacific Ocean. That's why the velocity of the tsunamis in that region is very high. What is the tsunami region? What is the velocity of the open ocean? More than 500 miles per hour. that is a tremendous velocity. The is almost equivalent to the or your flight and all are running on this speed only. So you have a tremendous velocity in open ocean about the tsunami waves. So you cannot have any bike and your whatever the train and whatever we are now traveling through, they are not reached to this speed velocity, but tsunamis are. So that's why tsunami is a very dangerous one. Once it get in, you are very you can say the it's very disastrous for all of us. So this is the example of the tsunami, some of the example of tsunami. This is a tsunami in Japan. You know that Japan is a country where you have a open earthquake and it's occur in a plate boundary, or located on a plate boundary. That's why you have more earthquake and the followed by the some of the tsunami. Some earthquakes are related to the tsunamis. So in Japan you have a tsunami in 2011, which is of having a depth or height of the waves is 90 feet height. So you can imagine that how much destructive this tsunami is. So up to 90 feet it can be get the height of 90 feet, and up to 2.5 miles of inundation. So means up to 4 to 5 kilometer inside your coastal region it get encroaches. So how much warning the people are received from the competent authority about this earthquake or about this tsunami? Only 8 to 10 minutes. So you can think that what kind of preparedness and what kind of all the readiness is needed to evacuate the people from this place to another place, for the such a scenario. This is a village of Minamaskeru, somewhere there. So which is, you can see the two pictures where all are the submerged under the water. All this village are submerged under the water. This is the town of Yagawahama. This is again the example of your Japan. Then you have Sendai Airport somewhere. So after this tsunami, Japan spent too much of money and too much of infrastructure over this one. So billion of dollar has been spent after this event. 40% of the Japan coastline contain up to 39 meter walls, high walls. Tsunami is destroyed. 6 foot wood structure, 12 foot concrete destroyed, 70 foot feet everything. So you have a multiple line of the protection in that area. So this is an automatic system or auto. Whenever there is an earthquake or a large earthquake, the you make, because you may not get a proper warning for the tsunami. But what is the cause behind the tsunami? The cause behind tsunami is your earthquake. So you may correlate the earthquake with the tsunami, because tsunami is mostly because of the earthquake. Sometimes the landslide in the oceanic, this one side, but it's very rare phenomena. So when you have an earthquake, you can automatically get some of the signal of that earthquake, because all the earth is covered by the different station, by the different agency, like from the NASA and the IMD and all the Japanese agencies and all. So USGS having so much of dense network of the seismic station all over the world, and they give us the data about the immediately after the within 1-3 minutes you get the data about the earthquake. What is the intensity? You get the data in the form of what is the intensity of the earthquake, that is in Richter scale or in Mercalli scale, intensity and the magnitude scale. Then you have your what we can say the exact location with the lat long that the, this is this happen in a your this is area. Then you have a location this one location magnitude and the depth. So you know that I already explained in the first few slides that the earthquake, the whatever the tsunamis are there, they are mostly related to the shallow depth earthquake. You have a shallow depth earthquake. For example, just I am giving you the so you have a different like this layers of the earth. So sometimes the your earthquake is happen here, but the focus is somewhere below. Sometimes it is on a 70 kilometer, sometimes 120 kilometer, sometimes 35 kilometer. So this one will range as a shallow depth earthquake. This one is a intermediate. And if there is a 700 kilometer or something like that, you have a deep earthquake. Okay, we have a deep earthquake. So shallow earthquake is the most affected this all the oceanic cycle and all oceanic waves and all is mostly connected by the this. So why we are studying about Japan mostly because the this phenomena this tsunami is not often hit to the other country like the Japan. Japan is having so much of knowledge about this one, so much advancement, and they all works together to avoid man on life loss during this period. So this is how tsunami can reach the greater height when they enter harbor or other narrow space. 8 meter wave and open coastline, 30 meter wave in narrow harbor. So when you have a narrow narrower the your space, you may have a more height of the waves. Obviously when you have a open space, you have a one of means your height is not that much, but when you have a closed space, narrow space, you have a more height. So the tsunami, when the tsunami is occurred to the toward the shoreline, toward the shoreline, one thing is happened with this one. They are less in the speed. They are less in the speed, but height is increased. So if they take away from that, height, the speed of this one is very reduced, but the height and the major factor for intrusion or in the inside the coastal area is the height. So you may have some restriction to the locals and restriction to the coastline that yes, you cannot build building in that specific area, but it's not happened because of the a very large area is covered by the tsunami, and the height of this one is also very high, that even though if you are a multi-story building, it can be submerged under the water during the tsunami. So tsunami warning, what kind of warning we or normally the get from the agencies? The coastal maps, the tsunami hazard of Hawaii Big Island based on local topography, coastal. So you, the remote sensing application is started that when you have known that this area is up to this area is maybe go under the water. So this is what you can do if you are facing the tsunami. So many lives are lost while trying to save possession. Okay, so you do not get panic. Stay still, stay confident, and you can save yourself during the tsunami also if you are following some instruction, and you can save yourself and your family. So if there is no high ground nearby, then climb on the upper floor of the roof of a strong building. If there is no sturdy building, then climb on a tree, grab onto something that float. So what happened in a tsunami? Particular thing about the tsunami is the height. Main thing which save you is the height. If you have a good place at a very high height, like 70-80 meters, and if you have multi-story building, so go on a roof or a top of that building. It's not like that you may survive, but the chances of get survival is highest at that point. So if you don't have anything, go to the building terrace or building, the upper space of the building, and go and stay there. If you don't have any building, go to the tree. So on a ground you have more chances of this tsunami will reach and shake on all the ground. So this is a what about us surviving during the tsunami. So this one, the 26 December 2004 earthquake in an island of Indonesia is a very disastrous one. It's very disastrous one that India is also getting some very good amount of shocks or good amount of tsunami waves in this particular event. The closest inhabited land to epicenter of magnitude 9.2 earthquake. The Indonesia in the 26 December is before that you have a 9.2 earthquake. After shaking stop, residents fled uphill immediately. Only 7 out of 75,000 inhabitants were killed. Oral history reminded people when ground shake, run to hill before giant wave arrived. Then you have a Chile earthquake. The Chile is also on a coastal region. That's why if there is an earthquake in this region, it's causing the tsunami. The magnitude 8.8 and hypocenter of this is the from the where the originated. This one is originated. It's at 21 miles. So magnitude and hypocenter is the two things which you can consider. This is how your tsunami is. Conception, move 10 feet or to the west. Move 10 feet to the west. So this is a Japan warning system about a tsunami. Time sequence to issue the tsunami warning and earthquake information. So first you have a seismic intensity information. You have a seismic intensity information about the earthquake. Earthquake and seismic intensity information is updated. Then you have a tsunami warning. Tsunami warning immediately get passed. एंड एस्टिमेटेड सुनामी हाइट एंड अराइवल. सुनामी इंफॉर्मेशन मीन्स इट्स नॉट लाइक दैट ओ सुनामी इज कमिंग. सो यू नीड अ प्रॉपर इंफॉर्मेशन एंड प्रॉपर पिक्चर अबाउट वॉट अप टू वॉट एक्सटेंड एंड वॉट इन किलोमीटर द एनक्रोचमेंट, वॉट इज द एनक्रोचमेंट इन किलोमीटर्स एंड वॉट इज द योर वॉट वी कैन से द हाइट ऑफ दैट सुनामी. So you have a seismic reporting station everywhere planted. I already explained you, USGS is having a seismic station. So how the tsunami warning has been transmitted to the from one place to the another. So first of all, you have a seismological monitoring network. You have a seismologically monitored network. And that monitor network get your what we can say the signal. Your that network get signal and that signal is get proceed in system and issue the warning of tsunami. And this is a model which is adapted by the Japanese agency. So you have a central government disaster management authorities which is a. Working in very hard in harsh in these conditions. They are their task is to after the any disaster or any earthquake, they have to go and stop this or go and help to other people. So this is how your tsunami warning system is. So once you have information about this one, you first inform to the central government agencies. Then you have a. Local government via police, fire officers, broadcasting, and your radio station. So these all are the different kind of these things. Then you have a Pacific tsunami warning system center, which is west to the North America. The remainder portion of the ring of the fire, National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Center, Pacific Marine Environmental Laboratory. So this one is a warning system center for this one. So tsunami is formed when a large volume of water is displaced from one place to the another place and one set of waves move onshore and another offshore. Waves arise in a series of shorter amount of time closer to the epicenter. Waves increase velocity with depth of ocean. So this is what about the tsunami, some of the facts. Now we come to the topic which is having a more interesting to you because you are a student of geoinformatics. So while remote sensing has been applied to monitor and understanding the physical process of tsunami hazard, the impact of societies and damage caused by disaster need to be addressed for disaster response. So when you have a remote sensing that is having a satellite and all is having a best of the technology which can be used for the tsunami hazards. In this sense, satellite remote sensing is advantageous when the impact is in a large scale and wide area is needed to be grasped rapidly. So satellite image, satellite data acquisition and fast data processing has increased through the this year due to the technological advances in constellation of your this one. The satellite data acquisition and fast data processing has increased through this year due to the technological advancement in the constellation of the satellite and the interest in archiving and sharing the information gathered by multiple sensors. Thus, remote sensing has been used to estimate possible damage after the major disaster. So, when the government is having some is that the affected people get 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs, but the mapping of that area and whether the really the things are going well or not, so they have to check this for this one. So in the tsunami also, while remote sensing has been applied to monitoring and understanding physical process and tsunami hazard, the impact to the societies and dynamic impact to the societies and damage caused by the disaster need to be addressed for disaster response. In this sense, satellite remote sensing is advantageous when the impact is on a large scale and wide area needed to grasp readily. Satellite data acquisition and fast data processing has been increased through these years due to the technological advancement in the constellation of. So you have so much of technological advancement that you can easily see this all on the this one. So the technological advancement we have to use for our purpose. Now in a tsunami or in remote sensing and GIS, using remote sensing, we can extract the a tsunami induction area zones. A tsunami induction zone. So changes in the normalized difference. Changes in the normalized difference vegetation index, that is the NDVI. You may form or you may study the NDVI, which is very basic and important parameter, which given you the difference kind of vegetation and water. So soil index, water index are used to extract the induced area. In particular cases, particular water body, water along the water boulevard on flooding, the use of this indices required a careful comparison of their indices before between the pre and post event image. So the value of this one, the value of this threshold maximize the difference between cumulative frequency distribution in order to define at least two classes. So you have to you may go and extract this all the tsunami area using remote sensing. Second application is a building damage. So whatever the building damage, so if you have a what the application of this remote sensing and GIS technology you can offer in here. If there is a tsunami and if anyone asks about what is the condition, what is the status of this area now, I want to see. So the interpretation and the building damage assessment can be done using the satellite data, different satellite data. So mapping the damage help improve disaster relief effectiveness and reduce suffering from the fatalities. Thus the Copernicus program and UN SPIDER and the Sentinel Asia initiative in the Copernicus program, the sum of the Earth observation system supporting disaster response using a remote sensing technology. To identify remote tsunami induced building damage, one can use optical pre post event images to visually inspect the artificial affected area, the observed changes in a building. So when you have a tsunami, so you can take the a picture before the tsunami and after tsunami, so you can directly visualize by your eyes that what kind of changes have been occurred in this all the area. To identify the tsunami induced building damage, one can use optically pre post event image to visually inspect the affected area and observe changes in the building. It is also used in a earthquake induced or hurricane induced damage assessment. Unfortunately, optical image required a free cloud condition and to clearly observe the earth surface. So optical data need a clear cloud condition, but you can think that yes, your data is coming from the oceanic side. So this is, if you have optical image of a good quality, you can easily assess the tsunami induced building damage. This is an example of mapping done on the structural damage of one of the city in Japan. So you have a pre-post event of the aerial photograph. The aerial photos archived were provided by Geospatial Information Authority of Japan with the Zernin building data. So if you have a building data, how much people are living there, what is the height of this one and all, you can easily get to for the next step. So this is what you can do with your remote sensing and GIS, that you can have assess the condition after your damage has been done. Like you have a 90 to 100 feet of water, and that all your the farming has been affected. So building damage can be traced back due to using the remote sensing and GIS technology. So interpretation of tsunami induced building damage. Tsunami-induced building damage can be measured. So this is you can have an interpretation of tsunami-induced building and damages. So this one is a example. This one is an example of having a two places. One of the places. Visual inspection of pre and post event aerial photos. The aerial photos archive were provided by the Geospatial Information Authority of Japan with the Zernin building data. So this is all about the tsunami, that what is the tsunami, what kind of operation we are generally considered for the tsunami, what is the cause of tsunami. The cause of tsunami is there, that whatever the condition, whatever the earthquake in your ocean in Pacific side, you are not allowed to do. So you can have this hazard map zonation, or you can say the zonation that is basically depend upon the zonation that is basically upon the depend upon the file in your different kind of data set. So while remote sensing has been applied to monitor and understand the physical process of tsunami hazards, the impact of the societies and damage caused by disaster need to be addressed in a disaster response. So this information, whatever you are intonation and this, so you can have a DEM. You can have a DEM with you, or download from SRTM and all. So you have a DEM with you, so you can measure the height of that surface and height of that building. And you may prepare a map suggesting that how much of the this one is the how much the your tsunamis get. If there is a 60 feet of the tsunami height of this waves is, if there is a 60 feet, how much of the area is undergoes to the water if there is a height of the 200 meters, at what extent it can be go the water tsunami waves, what extent it can be go. depending upon the deep and the this one what we can say the monitoring and this one understanding the physical process, we can have a tsunami damage interpretation. A tsunami damage interpretation. So the NDVI, I already explained, the NDVI is the best of the technique you can use to know about the NDVI and NDWI. So both are the extract the indurated area. In particular case, indurated area. In particular cases of particular body, the different kind of bands, and this one is used. So you have a pre. Carried out by this one is the coastline of Tamil Nadu, Kerala. Okay, so the tsunami is a tsunami is can be studied by the remote sensing and allied technology. This is what about all about the tsunami. Tsunami. This is your question you have. What does the word tsunami means in Japanese? What is the name of this wave? Witness have said approaching tsunami sound. What is the most active tsunami area? What is the most active tsunami area? Pacific Ocean. So most active and more you can have the what we can say the more the deeper the ocean, more the cycles of this one. What is the deadliest tsunami ever recorded? You can Google it and read about whether it is a Indian Ocean tsunami, whether it is a Northern Chile tsunami or all. So you can have a deadliest tsunami ever in term of the number of human life loss. And you have what is the frequency of warning sign of the impending tsunami. So you need to answer this all the question. After the question I have just look at here. This one is all are the maps of such like. Can join another class, Rishab.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So this is all from the today's lecture. Hope you understand this all the terms related to the tsunami, and you can find in more detail about in the different books and on a research paper that how much of the technological, what kind of data is best suited for tsunami, whether it is the optical data, it is the SAR data and all. So you can read more about which kind of GIS data set has been used here, what kind of satellite has been used for this one. So today we just see the tsunami, what is the tsunami, what is the causes of tsunami, and some application of geoinformatics in the tsunami. So beyond this one, if you want to add on the knowledge yourself, you can have read a research paper and a technological advancement and what kind of monitoring system and the alarm system has been updated from the time to time. So this is all about the tsunami. In India, it's way back that tsunami is not operating or not is having an impact. So it's good for us, all of us, that India is having a, don't having a, any kind of symbol. So this is about the tsunami, all about the tsunami. Hope you understand, and thank you for listening this lecture. Thank you all.